So I admit that I sometimes fall into a routine when it comes to how I edit my photos. It becomes something like a lather, rinse, repeat process. And while there's absolutely nothing wrong with having a tight workflow that provides you with consistent results, it's great to be reminded about the tools, tricks, and techniques that you might have forgotten about. It's like a chef who has gotten so used to grabbing the same old spices, only to one day remember that there are all these other flavors to explore with their dishes. And so for me, that long overlooked technique is Photoshop's tilt shift blur. It's one of those tools that can add just the right amount of pizzazz to a photo, but only if the composition lends itself to it. Back in the day, I used to own several Canon tilt shift lenses, and I admit that I seriously overabused the tilt function of those lenses because it negatively impacted the quality of my photos. But every now and then I'll find a photo that I know will benefit from the tilt shift blur effect, and that's what I'm going to show you in this video. So let's dive in. All right, so we are in Lightroom, and this is an unedited photo I took at this beautiful picturesque scene in Slovenia. You can see this, just this quaint church over here and these little structures, this little village, and of course, the rolling hills and the mountains behind it. This is just like one of those beautiful scenes, and it was at the time of day where the sun was cutting through at just the right time at the right angle, and it was illuminating the church on the hilltop. I just love this kind of a photo. And so what I want to do now is show you just a quick and dirty Lightroom editing workflow. This is how I would approach the photo. And then we're going to bring it over to Photoshop where I'll apply a tilt shift blur. And when we get to that point, I'll explain to you the types of compositions that I feel are best served with a tilt shift blur. So how will I edit this photo? Well, first few things that I do right off the bat is I apply a custom white balance. So I'll go over here to color. I'll click on, say, some of this gray snow there, and that gets rid of a little bit of that color cast. There wasn't much, but it just looks a little bit more neutral now. Next, I'm going to go all the way to the bottom here to optics and make sure that I have lens correction enabled. You can also remove chromatic aberration if you think that your image suffers from it. I'll also go here to crop, and I'm just cropping in from the top right. You can see here there's this little structure that's kind of at the edge of the frame that I want to get rid of, so I'm just going to crop in just a tiny bit, just like that. That's all I need. And for the most part, we're pretty much done. I often will change the profile from Adobe Color to Adobe Landscape. I don't know, I'm just partial to the change it makes to the overall look, especially changing the curve and changing the color of the image. Also, before I start working on light and color, sometimes I'm going to go to the color calibration panel, and I've got a video on what this panel does. I'll put a card right above, but you can see if you don't have it in Lightroom, in this version of Lightroom, you can enable it by going to the ellipsis over here and then enabling show color calibration. I believe it is off by default. And of all the sliders here, the blue primary saturation slider is probably the most powerful. And so I like to bring that out usually between 50 and 100. It really depends on the qualities of the photo. I don't really touch any of the other sliders. Sometimes I will, depending again on the content of the photo, but for this purpose, the blue saturation slider is perfect. All right, now let's go ahead. Let's open up exposure just a bit here. I'm also going to bring the white point out just until we start to, there, we start to blow out the highlights, and then I'm going to bring it back. And same thing with the black point right around here looks good. I'm going to open up shadows just a bit. And the reason why I'm doing that now is because right after this, I'm going to deepen the shadows with this point curve. Let's also open up the highlights a little bit. And so if we toggle the light panel, you can see it just does a really nice job of kind of making it look just not punchy, but the tones look correct. Whereas before that, it looked a little bit flat. Now let's go ahead. I mentioned that I'm going to apply an S curve, which is one of my favorite ways to add contrast to a photo. So dropping a dot here in the highlight region and bringing it up, then dropping a dot here in the shadow region and bring it down. And you can see how we now have contrast. And then sometimes I'll drop a dot in the middle here for the midtones. If I bring it to the right, it kind of makes the midtones a little bit flatter. If I bring it to the left, it makes them a little bit brighter. So something like this. And then depending on a photo, if it has a lot of shadows, I will sometimes take the black point, which is indicated by this bottom left corner. And if I bring it up, I'll start to introduce a little bit of gray into the darkest parts of the image, which gives you that vintagey look, which I think lends itself really nicely here. Now, when you do add a curve adjustment, it can add saturation to the photo, so you can refine that, which I do. I'm going to bring this down to about 40%, just reducing that saturation that was added because it was getting a little bit punchy. And then I'm also going to go to the blue channel here, and in the highlights, I'm going to add a little bit of kind of that orangey yellow just to warm it. You could see how the image gets really nice and warm, but not like overly warm. It's almost like imperceptible how little I added here, but it adds a nice touch. All right, going further down, I'm not going to add any saturation, but I will add a tiny bit of a vibrance boost. Let's just see. Yeah, that does a good job. I'm happy with the color adjustments here. Next, let's go down and add some effects. Let's add just some detail here to the photo. So let's zoom in. I'm going to zoom out. It's a bit too close. Let's go to 200. Actually, let's go to 100 here. All right, that's good because I want to see the effects of these three sliders on the little church here and the trees in the background. So for texture, I'm going to add a little bit of texture until I start to see kind of the branches and also the overall structure get a little bit more defined. And then I'm also going to add a tiny bit of dehaze, which is basically adding contrast to the midtones of the edges here. So I have a video that I recently did on these three sliders, so definitely check that out. And then the last thing that I want to do before we head over to Photoshop is I just want to bring out a little bit more of the presence in the sky using dehaze. So to do that, I'm going to go to masking tools here. I'm going to click on sky, and then I'm going to do my sky technique here that will refine the selection. You can see how it's kind of bleeding onto the mountains. And so the way that I like to explain it is after you select the sky, click subtract, select sky again, and then on that subtract layer, go to the ellipsis and invert it. And so with the sky selected here, I'm going to go to the effects section and I'm going to add a little bit of dehaze. And you can see what it's doing. If you do too much, it looks terrible. So I'm going to back off, but it's just adding a little bit more definition to the sky. It's bringing out the blues in the sky and allowing you to see the clouds a little bit more clearly. Actually, I'm going to back it off just a little bit right around there. All right, so now we're done. You can see here, if I press the backslash key, that is the unedited photo. And with just, you know, a few sliders and a mask, it just looks so much better. But what I want to do is I really do want to bring emphasis to this plane over here, this kind of diagonal plane with these structures here and, of course, the little church on the hilltop. And so what I want to do is send this photo to Photoshop, and all I need to do is right click on the image and go to edit in Photoshop. All right, so here you can see I am in Photoshop 2024. This is not the beta, this is the public release. And the first thing I'm gonna do is take the background layer and drag it onto this plus icon, which will duplicate it. So now I have a separate layer. And then I'm gonna right click and select convert to smart object. And I'll explain that in a minute. You'll know it's a smart object because on the bottom right of the thumbnail, there's this little icon over here. I'm also going to click here and rename this. I'm gonna call this tilt shift blur, just so I can identify it later. Now, before I show you how to use the tilt shift blur, I mentioned that I was gonna explain which compositions are served best by this filter or this technique. Generally speaking, in my experience, the reason why you apply a tilt shift blur, or at least the reason why I do it, is when you do it effectively, the composition takes on this kind of miniature world effect, almost like these little toy models are placed in your image. Several years ago, I think it was Allstate, there was an insurance company that did this really effectively. They created a series of commercials using this tilt shift effect, and all of the cars and the houses looked like little figurines, little toy models. And so when I see a composition that has a certain quality to it, which I'll show you right now, the tilt shift effect immediately pops in mind. So the quality that I'm talking about is when you are above your subject. So you can see how I'm clearly standing on a hill above my subject, which is these structures here. If your subject, let's say it's a car or a house or people, if you're standing above them, especially if you are, for example, using a drone and you're flying in the air, but not too high, you don't want to be too high, but you are above them, this is where the tilt shift effect will really play out strongly. So because I am above my subjects, when I apply the tilt shift blur, it will take on kind of like a toy model figurine effect. If I was standing kind of parallel with the structures here, it wouldn't be as effective. And that's why in the intro of this video, I mentioned how I over abused the tilt function of my Canon tilt shift lenses. I would tilt in all of my shots. Like if you were to look at my older photos from like 2007, 2008, I tilted with almost everything. There was no reason for it. Really, it's when you're kind of are above your subject, that's when it really helps. So we've established that I am above my subject, especially again, if you fly your drone and use your drone to take a lot of photos, give this a shot. So to access tilt shift blur, you'll go to the filter menu, you'll go to blur gallery, and then you'll see right here, there is tilt shift blur. So let's go ahead and use that. And so tilt shift blur is pretty straightforward. There's not much to it. You can see here, there's blur and distortion. I don't really ever use distortion, but blur controls the blur strength. As far as how the control works, if you put your cursor here in the middle, you can move this around. And so what I'm gonna do is kind of place this over here. You don't need to put it on your subject, but I like to, only because it also kind of serves as the axis for rotation, which I'll show you right now. And so like most linear filters or linear gradient tools like we have in Lightroom, you have a hard edge and a soft edge. And so the hard edge, the bottom hard edge is this solid line, the top hard edge is this one. And then you can see that we have a broken line. This is your feather. So this controls the transition from the hard edge or the full effect to the effect turning off. Or in this case here, it's the opposite. It's gonna blur everything outside of the broken line. And then as it transitions to the solid edge, it becomes sharp. So I mentioned that I want kind of this plane over here of these structures to be sharp and everything else blurry. And so what I'm gonna do is put my cursor over here until it turns into this curved double arrow. And you can see how it's kind of rotating on the axis where that pin is, which is on the church. And so I'm making it kind of at this kind of aggressive angle. Maybe let me bring it back just a little bit here, like around there. And then let me move it down. Okay, so here you can see now we have this kind of swatch that's sharp and then it falls out of focus. Now, what I'm also going to do is reduce the feather. I want kind of this structure to be out of focus. So I'm bringing the feather closer. And then same thing here, what I'm gonna do is I'm going to bring this down and then I'm going to increase that feather until some of those treetops look sharp over here. So right around here, I'm gonna bring it a little bit further up and you can start to see that the treetops are getting a little bit more in focus. And even when I magnify it, do you see how like it kind of looks like a toy kind of figurine? Like these trees look like little toys, like that they were planted on. And so I don't know, it just looks really cool to me. And then what you can do is take the blur amount and you can increase it if you want it to be obviously more dramatic. I will give you a word of caution. Like most things, including spices that you put into your food, a little bit goes a long way. If you have a really strong blur amount, it's just gonna, the effect will fall apart. It's gonna look completely unreal. There is a little bit of suspension of disbelief with these kinds of photos, but subtlety is your friend. So I'm gonna keep it at 32% because I wanna illustrate the importance of smart objects. So let's go ahead here. Let's say I'm done with the effect. I'm gonna click on okay, and it's gonna process and then bring us back into Photoshop. And so you can see this does kind of look like little figurines, especially if you toggle the layer here. It looks really cool. I love it. But as you can see, maybe the feather is too abrupt. Maybe the blur strength is too much. Well, because we created a smart object before going into the blur gallery, all I need to do now is double click on blur gallery and it brings me back with everything intact. We have the selection here intact. We have our blur strength intact. So what I can do now is refine it. I can bring this the strength slider down to about 20. Maybe I want to increase that feather. And maybe I want to have high quality bokeh by enabling this checkbox there. Then let's click OK again. And so this looks a lot better. The blur isn't as in your face, but we still retain that toy figure look, which I love. And so if this video kind of jazzes you up and makes you want to amp up your landscape photo editing workflows, please check out my course called Lightroom Landscapes. The link is in the description below. It's got tons of additional techniques to help you get a really good system in place with how you edit your landscape workflow. So you're not just kind of jumping around. It's actually a very systematic approach. Hope you check it out. Again, the link is in the description below. And if you want to learn more about how Lightroom works, I've got this playlist with tons of videos, so be sure to check it out. If you found this video helpful, as always, a thumbs up is greatly appreciated, and be sure to click on the subscribe button and the bell icon to get notified of all future videos. Thanks a lot, everyone.